So, hello, welcome to today's Hacker Praktikum. First of all, I'd like to make a quick announcement for those who don't know me yet. My name is Carsten Tellmann. I work for GData, that's a local antivirus company, and we are sponsoring this course to make it possible to invite international speakers. And in addition to these courses, we offer a small informal evening event. Every time we have an internal international speaker here, we offer this follow-up event, and we have a quite cozy atmosphere there with a nice location. We offer some Indian food today with some drinks, and I'd like to invite all of you. If you have detailed questions, come to me after the talk, and if you're interested in talking to the speaker a little bit more in detail, or if you like to talk to some of the more technical guys working in an antivirus company, you're welcome, and I think that's quite a nice opportunity. So, I think you introduced yourself. So
yes. Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Michele. Today we will speak about beef. I always speak about beef, so it's like spamming, but okay. So I'm working currently in Spider Labs in London for Trustwave, application security mainly. I really like to develop something in JavaScript and Ruby. In fact, beef is written in Ruby and JavaScript. And I like the OpenBSD operating system. And I'm the lead core developer of Beef, so not a lot of info, but. So the outline of the talk, as you can read there, is quite long. So I guess we will need something around 1 hour and 20 minutes maximum. I will be depending on the duration of the demos, because they are live, as Felix recommended me in Vienna. So I guess every one of you is familiar with those concepts, so XSS, HTTP response splitting, phishing, man in the middle. So I'm not covering, I'm not doing an introduction of that of those topics in a way that we have more time to speak about beef. So we will see. We will have a brief introduction about beef. How many of you knows beef or did use it before? 5, 6, okay, cool. So let's introduce beef first. So these are a few screenshots that are quite chaotic and random, but the idea is that beef it stands for Browser Exploitation Framework. So basically, beef is a framework that enables you to do post-exploitation whenever you have a situation when you can execute JavaScript code. So with an XSS, with HTTP response splitting, with a phishing page, doing man in the middle, injecting other scripts, for example, with EtherCAP rules. If you want to play on Tor exit nodes, you can do it. That is, maybe in German is not a good recommendation, but. So the point is that every time you have a browser has exposed different kind of plugins, different kind of technologies, different types of browser, different types of operating systems. So every time you have a completely different environment. And as when you do a pen test, you try obviously to exploit all those kind of things. So in case of beef, if you can see that you can control three browsers and one is Internet Explorer 6, then you can you like maybe to launch an Aurora exploit, or if it's in Firefox certain version that is not vulnerable, you like maybe to proceed with some kind of social engineering tricks. So the point of beef is basically help you on post exploitation with XSS mainly. So I don't know how many of you are pen testers. Yeah, Marcus is always and well, Felix. Okay. By the way, usually where you have an XSS, you send to your customer a proof of concept that is like, I don't know, script alert one, and you see a pop-up, okay? And you see, okay, I can execute JavaScript, or you can send back the document cookie value, and so you can steal the cookie. That's fine, but that's actually, I mean, the client can say, so what? I mean, an alert box, so did you pwn me? No. Or maybe if you are sending back the cookie, but you have an application that is preventing session hijacking because it's checking, for example, the IP, the source IP, or the user agent, you cannot, even stealing the cookie, you cannot write the victim session. So, I mean, with Beef, actually, what you can do is injecting, instead of doing a script alert one close script, you can actually inject a completely different script tag with the source that is pointing to a location where all the JavaScript functions are retrieved, added to the victim browser, rendered and executed. Okay, so that is basically a very high level architecture of how Beef works. So we have like a component that is like the Beef command server, the Beef user interface that is connecting to the command server, and all those zombies are basically browsers that are executing our JavaScript code somehow. So via social engineering, via just if it's a persistent XSS, for example, just browsing the website, you can do as I said, man in the middle, and you can modify the HTTP responses, for example, or you can have just simple phishing pages. Okay, so all those victims are victims that we can control in Beef. And for the first time, I spent a few hours creating a nice diagram that is helping you understanding how the cooking process works. So we have the Beef server, the Beef framework on the left, and a Chrome browser on the right. Okay. What's happening is that if you have, for example, in XSS, and you write script src, and then you put that URL. That URL obviously is pointing to a resource that is exposed by Beef, so hook.js. The first step is basically you could see also the arrow on the other side, because basically the server is serving the request, but the browser was requesting it first. By the way, the JavaScript is going to be executed by the browser. When what's up? The next step is basically that after the JavaScript is inside the browser of the victim, so in the DOM of the victim browser, the next step is basically that Beef init, the function Beef init is called. So Beef init, when Beef init is called, if the page is loaded, basically what you can do is get the browser details, as you can see there. Execute commands, check for new commands, and start the logger. I will show you a few examples of these things, because I know it could be difficult to understand otherwise. But after the Beef init function is called, this is what is happening later. Okay, so basically the victim browser starts to poll the same file that was requested and served before. Every time the victim browser is polling Beef, the response is always zero. So content length zero, because in case you don't have to send anything to the victim, okay? In this way, with this polling, we are able to understand if the victim is still up and not down, okay? So for example, if you have a reflected XSS and the victim closed the tab, you lose the victim and you don't see the polling anymore. So until you see the polling, the victim is up. So what's happening if the Beef administrator wants to send a module? Basically, what will happen is the following. So we have like a wrapper that is called Beef execute. And inside of that, you basically add the JavaScript that you want to be sent and executed by the browser. So for example, in this case, a simple prompt. What will happen is that on the next polling, the response from the poll will not be zero, but will contain actually that code. Okay, and then in other parts of the beef JavaScript client side, that response will be parsed and added to a stack of functions to be called. So, for example, in this case, it's beef commands. This beef commands is like a stack, so you add all the contents of this. Where is my mouse? I don't see it. Well, you add all the contents of what is sent, like beef execute. So basically, when you do a pop on the stack, and then you do try in case there is an exception, so you don't break the flow of the other beef functions. Try CMD. So basically, you are trying to execute prompt. Okay. So obviously, when you do that, you see the final result is the prompt dialog. Okay. So this is generally how the communication between a victim browser that is executing our JavaScript and beef works. Obviously, the communication is working also on the other direction. So every time we need to get a response from get some results back to beef. So, for example, what the victim entered on that prompt form, we want to know that. So we have other callbacks and other functions that are sending back to beef the information in the same way. So basically, you just do like get or post request to beef, and you get, for example, the response of this prompt dialog. So the communication channel of beef is what is called XHR polling, okay? Because basically there are XML HTTP requests that are executed every X seconds or X milliseconds, depending on what kind of delay you want to add. By default, it's 1 second. But anyway, obviously, this is not efficient, because every time, let's say that you need to execute a command every 10 minutes, so you get hundreds of thousands of requests, and you don't need them. Always with a content length zero, just to check if the browser is alive. Okay, so even with the keep alive features, this is still not efficient. So as you know, HTML with HTML5 that is supported on latest browser like Chrome, Safari, Firefox, and not Opera until, I don't know when Opera will be ready for it, and Internet Explorer. WebSockets are the way forward. So WebSocket is basically like a streaming protocol. By default, like in Firefox, you have 16 megabytes of data that you can send in a single stream. And it's the idea of the protocol is basically this. So you can achieve really amazing performance, amazing speed, and also reliability. And also, the point is that I will show you a lot of demo later, so don't be bored. But for example, if you open Firebug, you will, and in a page where the victim is executing our hook, obviously you see all the polling requests in the net tab. Instead, with WebSockets right now, you don't see anything. You see just like switching protocols, and that's all. Also, with WebSockets, you can achieve in a very simple way data transport security, because it's enough to, for example, with the WebSocket server we have in Ruby, it's just enough to point the server-side code to a certificate, and you just, instead of using the protocol handler WS, you use WSS, and so you have WebSocket secure. So you have the benefit that the whole data communication is also encrypted. So, yeah. The nice thing about, as I said, TLS, the only disadvantage of this is that, let's say that you have beef. I mean, obviously, all your hooked browser will never be Chrome 18, Firefox 12, and stuff like that. You can have, unfortunately, Internet Explorer 7, for example. Fortunately or unfortunately, depending on what you need to do with it. So you need support still the XHR polling, the old channel, anyway. So you switch to the WebSocket channel only if the browser supports it, okay? So in case you need to run BEEF on like for port 443 with a valid certificate that you bought, so you need to run the WebSocket server on a different port. Sometimes you get some issues with outbound personal firewalls. So outbound firewalls is what I mean is personal firewall, like zone alarm. Sometimes there are issues with that. So we are still, I'm still debugging it to understand the best solution to it. Also, another disadvantage is that, for example, no, nothing. Forget. Sorry, I'm a bit tired. So, yeah, now the fun part starts. Let me show you BEEF before covering this part. So, false. Okay, so BEEF is started. So you can see here that this is basically the is listening on every interface available. So and it's giving you also the URI that you can use to in your exploit. So this is basically the hook URL that you will use, for example, on the source of your script tags, for example, and then you have like the panel. So if you connect to the panel here, okay, this is the BEEF web user interface, and here you will see all the hooked browser. Let me just change this on this for later. Okay, so for example, if with Firefox, so on Firefox I'm connecting to a different IP, that think, okay, dumb vulnerable application. Okay. By default, the security level is low. Otherwise, it's using PHP IDS, and we don't want that right now. So here you have a classic example of reflected XSS. So what's your name, Michele? And you see the content, Michele, that is exactly reflected in the page. Okay. So if I change it, you see it here. So, and you can also see that, for example, the tags are not escaped. So you can see it here in bold. So this is a classical example of an XSS. So this is what you do, and also you see here. So what we can do here is actually, instead of writing Ciccio, we can actually put this. So, let me persist this. Okay. You see here the victim, and you can see here that basically this is the response of the hook file, so it's a lot of it's quite huge. Then we implemented minified and everything, so we are working on reducing the dimension of that, obviously. But this is like the default hook with a lot with all the functions that you may need. So in cases you don't need like 3/4 of the functionality, you just strip it down and it will be like 30k. And this is basically what I said. So the polling. So every second and a half, more or less, the victim is polling us. So hook.js, 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 the content is always zero, okay? Until, for example, we don't inject a command. Okay? You can see here that the response was 769 bytes. Okay. And the response is, in fact, is as the like in the example that I show you, beef execute function, and inside of that, you can see var answer prompt what, beef net send, and this is basically the function to send back data to beef. Okay, to the correct handler, so in this case the dialog.js with the command ID and with the answer that is basically populated with the response that I will enter just now. Okay, so like nothing, the thing is sent back, and you can see here the response. Okay, this is like a very simple example. When a browser is hooked in beef, you can see already a lot of things. So fingerprinting by default, and this is basically what is happening with browser details. So we identify the browser name, version, all the plugins supported, various technologies that are exposed, like Google Gears in this case is not supported, ActiveX not because it's not Internet Explorer. And other things like hostname IPs, cookies, and the screen size, and so on. And then you see the logs. And then the most interesting thing is this. So you have basically, we have more than 100 commands categorized with by basically the meaning of them. So from exploits, like the JBoss JMX exploit, where you can basically buy in the version 6.0.0 M1 and a few versions before, you could basically bypass the login of the JMX console with a head request and then deploy when they add an authentication. And then deploy a reverse JSP, for example, or a war with a reverse JSP, reverse shell anyway. And also the last Glassfish bug, that is still something similar to the JBoss one, regarding the fact that you can upload a war, has been ported as well, and a few other things. Other older bugs, like there was a bug in 1 year ago in Safari, where you can launch like netstat and other commands through Safari, very nice stuff. And things like that. So in your pen test, sometimes can happen that you can find in the internal network of the victim, for example, a vulnerable JBoss server, using, for example, other modules that we have, like JavaScript port scanners and network fingerprinters. And you can, in this way, you can identify internal services that are in the victim network that are not exposed to internet, so maybe they're not firewalled or hardened properly, and you can exploit them only via the browser. If you have some questions, just don't wait until the end, but feel free to ask them while I'm explaining it. So another very good thing that we integrated was XSS Rays. You remember for sure Gareth Ice, that was speaking here a few months ago. He's a very cool guy, and he developed various things and XSS Race was one of his projects in 2009 for Microsoft. So a pure JavaScript-based XSS scanner. Now, it's basically working in the following way. If you have a page with links, forms, and stuff like that, and you have an XSS on that page, what you can do is actually parsing all the links and all the form actions that you find, okay? Obviously, because you have complete access to the same domain, okay? And by default, this is working only right now only on a simple page, but I need to write a JavaScript crawler to crawl the whole domain. And what you are doing in XSS Race, after identifying all the links and all the action forms, is basically creating iframes where the source of those iframes are pointing to those links or form actions locations. And you basically blindly inject vectors, XSS vectors, and trying to identify XSS. Now, so this is basically a resume. So you serve the XSS, step one, you serve the XSS race to the victim. Then the XSS race is executed and loaded into the DOM. You crawl the links, and then, as you can see in point 3.2 on the right, you can see that, for example, an iframe that is pointing to xt.com page 2 mail blah. So that could be a potentially vulnerable parameter, at least I don't know, reflected XSS. So you just create different iframes with the same source, and the only thing that is different is that red part. That is basically the vector that you are using. You are proceeding completely blindly, so obviously you need to have a good library of scripts and things like that. Or you can also add some logic to the whole link parser, but that's out of scope. So Gareth Ice was doing it using the hash, like getting information between parent and child iframes with stuff after the hashtag. This is obviously patched after 2009. So what we did in Beef to make it working is what you can see in the red text. So all the vectors that we are injecting, obviously not all the vectors are scripts, but there are a lot of things. All the vectors are actually, if they are successfully executed, the document location href of the iframe is pointing to a BIF URL. Okay, so in this way, you don't have false positive. It's impossible to have a false positive because if you get a connection, it means that the JavaScript was executed. Okay, obviously you can have obviously false negatives because you are proceeding completely blindly. For example, if in that example, that mail parameter is vulnerable to reflected XSS, when the iframe will be loaded, obviously all the iframes are hidden, so the victim doesn't see anything, and I will show this later. The location of the iframe will be changed, and a GET request will be made to BIF, as you see in point 5, and so we can register exactly where was the injection, what was the vector we used, and stuff like that. Obviously, if an application is using X-frame options with something different than same origin, so you can't create iframes, okay? But from my pen testing experience, X-frame options are almost never used. Also, frame busting codes are using very rarely, only on very big websites. A lot of times we see that they are using X-frame option, same origin. Obviously in this case, XSS Race still works because we are loading resources from the same origin. So you cannot inject, for example, an iframe that is pointing to the black hole or crime pack, but you can still use XSS Race. all, everything works respecting the cross-domain, the same origin policy, and is working cross-domain. So let's have a very small demo. So I'm okay. Okay, so in Firefox, I'm opening a page that contains the BIF hook, okay? And the source of the page is this one. So BIF hook, and then there is a link that is pointing to a different domain. To a different, I mean, this is a different domain from the same origin policy because the AP is the same, protocol is the same, but the port is different, okay? And it's pointing to a resource that I already know that is vulnerable to ReflectXSS, but just for demo purposes. So if I do this, let me check console. So I start XSS race. Okay, these are the logs that can be disabled, obviously. So you can see that actually iframes are created dynamically, and those iframes are creating are pointing to resources that are basically the one that have been crawled. Okay. Sometimes, obviously, you get bad requests and stuff like that. And we already received a array, so basically a GET request that is contacting us back. Okay. And if you see the logs, you can see what vector name was successfully executed, so standard script injection double quote. And you can have a POC also that you can just copy. You see also the methods if you want GET or POST. And you can in fact confirm that it was vulnerable. So basically, in this way, in case, for example, that the application that is hooked is an internal application or not, is a public application that is pointing to some internal resources, okay, that are accessible only if the browser is the one of the victim, for example. In this way, you can basically extend your attack surface, because after you identify an XSS, for example, in an internal resource, you can trigger the victim to open a new tab, loading another BIF hook. And so you will see here yet another browser that is basically the same, but in a different tab. Okay. Okay. Here is the thing is running and. We can stop it. Yes. Okay. So a few announcements from the previous months. Now XSS Race works on every browser, including Internet Explorer 6 to 10. And they had very nasty, especially in Internet Explorer 6, they had very nasty bugs. We added new vectors. And the nice thing is that XSS Race is working also on Chrome and Safari, so WebKit browser that they implement the XSS auditor, but there are many bypasses. So Mario, Marcus, they know more than me about these bypasses of the XSS auditor. But right now I'm just using a very simple trick that is still an open bug that I don't know if they are going to patch, because it's open by more than one year. So basically, if you base64 the iframe source, the XSS auditor will not be able to decode that base64 data. So you use data URI vectors where you specify basically this. Yeah. So if the browser is Chrome or Safari, you do base64 the URL, and the source of the iframe will use actually the base64 value using a normal data URI prefix. Otherwise, you use the normal vector. Okay. So in this case, we achieved support only also on those browsers. Another nice thing is about Chrome extension. So there are people like Christoph Kotowicz, that is a close friend, and for example, the course, another guy from US that are doing also Black Hat course, Black Hat workshop this year in Vegas, only about Chrome extension exploitation, stuff like that. So this is actually a nice topic, because with Chrome extensions, if you are able to trigger the victim to install your extension, the extension obviously is malicious and can do really a lot of stuff. So this is basic. Every Chrome extension has a JSON file that is called manifest, where you define like the name, description, and the most important thing is the last part, permission. So this Chrome extension has permission to access all your tabs, all the open tabs, do cross-domain request on HTTP and HTTPS protocol, and also on the file protocol. The file protocol is interesting because there were some bugs with the same origin policy in the past. He also got access to all your cookies, also the one marked with HTTP only. So the result will be this one. I will show you a demo in a sec. The IP that you see on the left, the 10.90.80.261, was the original tab of Chrome that was hooked in Beef. The second one, the last one, was actually the Chrome extension that was basically hooked after being injected. Obviously, the user needs always to click OK. Okay, but I will show you a nice trick. All the other ones, the active browsers, are basically all the tabs. For example, the one that you can see here is the LinkedIn. All the active tabs that were not hooked in Beef, but as the extension has access to all the tabs, we can inject the Beef hook on all the tabs as well. So we can get other, I don't know, if you have 10 tabs open, you can get other 10, you can have access with Beef to all the other domains that are open in the tab, in the different tabs. And this is pretty cool because you don't need, in this case, you just exploit the trust that the user has on something, for example, a flash update in Chrome, and you can exploit even things that are not vulnerable to XSS. For example, it was better to have internet, but it doesn't matter. Let me think. Yeah.
Jeff?
Yes.
I want to say that one of the guys which are giving the Black Hat to a corporate was Christoph Kotowicz, or this Christoph Kotowicz, which was also here in the Apple Echo.
Yeah. Christoph and the COS as well. Yes. Yeah. Cool guy. No. Dio. Okay, we don't have any extensions, as you can see. So we have, no, let me open the beef in this one. Okay. So we have Chrome with the user is logged in the vulnerable application. We don't have any extension installed. Chrome is the latest version, almost the latest version, or whatever. Now we are going to hook Chrome with the same page used before. This one. Okay. Now. We want to use the fake flash update. Okay. So basically, on the flash fake flash update, you just configure when you before sending the module to the victim, you just configure the correct IP of the beef server for the splash image for the Chrome extension, and when you do execute, yeah. So basically, you see this fake Adobe Flash Player is available. As you see, it's completely, you know, all invisible from the victim. You do install. Yes, for sure. Continue. The obviously Chrome is alert, is saying be careful because who cares? I mean, everyone do add. Okay, so you see this Adobe Flash, you see also Chrome extension. So this is okay, but the yeah, but you see here the Chrome. A new hooked browser that in fact the hostname IP, this is basically the Chrome extension ID. Okay, now the nice thing is the following. So if I do commands and I do Chrome extensions, okay, we have a few nice modules. So for example, if in another tab you have Gmail open, I send this, grab Google Contacts, and this is, believe me, still working because I think they didn't implement anti-cross-site request forgery tokens on a particular call to export in CSV all the contacts that you have. So it's still working. So if you have basically one tab open with Gmail, with a simple click, you can steal the contacts of all the contacts of your victim. In this case, we want to do this: inject beef, execute, and you see here a new hooked browser is coming soon. Wait a sec. Yeah, okay. And this one. And as you can see, basically the beef hook has been injected in this tab that was dumb vulnerable web application. So in fact, you can see the WVA, PHP session ID, and everything. Without having the application could be something without any kind of vulnerability. So, and also, the result is this one, and is this one. So at home, I tried the same thing, having LinkedIn open in another tab, and you got everything you need. Obviously, when you are doing this, as I wrote, be sure to run beef on HTTPS with a valid certificate, because sometimes LinkedIn, it was not the case on LinkedIn, but like on Gmail, this technique was not working. So like injecting the beef hook dynamically in another tab, because there were some checks to see if plain text context, there were some content that was added that was not HTTPS. So that's why LinkedIn didn't check. Well, they have been breached as well. So be sure to run beef on HTTPS with a valid domain, with a valid certificate. Yeah, actually, it's less than what I thought. So we have only the last part. So beef tunneling proxy. The idea of the beef tunneling proxy was was originally researched by Ferruma Vittuna, a guy that now wrote NetSparker, was working for Portcullis, clever guy. And then also there was some research by a colleague of mine, Lava Kumar Kuppan, that did a similar thing using WebSockets. Now the point is that both of them used a server-side part that was written in ASP. So, you know, I don't like particularly Microsoft product, and I didn't bother to install an IIS server with ASP or Mono on Apache with all the issues that you can have, okay? So what we did is actually we took the idea, but we implemented the whole thing in Beef, so in Ruby, and wherever you can run Ruby, you can run this concept. And the idea is basically the following. If you have an XSS and you have a server-side component, you can bind the socket on the port, I don't know, 4567 with Ruby. This socket basically will be used by your browser to connect to it, as it is like a BARP proxy or whatever proxy is it. When an HTTP request is coming to the proxy, this request is parsed, okay, and is translated by Beef in an AJAX request. The AJAX request is then added to the, is then sent to the victim, and basically we say, okay, this is the request I want to, like, I want to do a GET on this page. Okay, I translate the raw request in an AJAX request, for example, with jQuery. Execute it, please. Okay, the browser executes it. You get the response in JavaScript. Then the response is sent to Beef. Some headers are stripped, like gzip, because it's automatically handled by the client, and date and stuff like that. And then it's the original HTTP, a new HTTP response, a raw HTTP response is reconstructed based on the original jQuery response, and is sent back to the socket. So in this case, in this way, you can have like an equivalent of a proxy with XSS. Yeah, I did more than one year ago. I did a cool video where I show how to use BARP and SQL map to the proxy. It was very slow because it was using the old XHR polling channel. So now with WebSocket is much faster. When you can use the tunneling proxy, basically wherever you, for example, in all those strict pen testing situation, when you cannot, when you need to hijack the session of the victim, but the application is employing techniques like source IP checking, user agent that can be spoofed, but sometimes can be tricky, and whatever other measures. Okay, the point is that with this technique, you don't need any cookie, because basically the cookie is automatically added to the request when the AJAX request is arriving to the victim. So in that moment, you say, okay, use also the cookies, and the request is done for you. So you don't steal any cookies, and yeah, the whole thing is working. So the demo of this. So let me, mettiamo questo qua, mettiamo qua. Yeah, this, as you can see, you can achieve also persistence with the Chrome extension. So yeah, nice. Okay, so now let's go back to damn vulnerable web application. Okay, we're logged in. Okay, so let's hook this browser again. Well, I guess this is enough. Yes, okay. So this browser is hooked. In Opera, cookies, we don't have, no, okay, let's delete everything, close, history, clear, empty now, okay, so Opera is perfectly clean. So what I do now is right click, use Xproxy, so using Hooked Browser with IPv4, blah, 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 Xproxy. Then from here, obviously I sent to the victim the injection, so obviously I know where to browse, but anyway. I copy the URL that I want to use. I set up the proxy here. So by default, BIF binds a socket on port 6789 on localhost only. Okay. Yes. Okay. Now it should work. Yeah. Now this is with the normal XHR polling, and you see how it's slow. Then sometimes there are issues with CSS, and there are still some bugs. But by the way, as you can see here, this is what's happening. Now, if we do the same thing, but we enable WebSockets through, and Ruby beef -x, and we rehook the browser, okay. And we clean again everything. As you can see, I don't have any cookie, but I'm not authenticating as well. That's because the tunneling process is taking care of that automatically. Cookies, no cuts, history, empty, clear, okay. So now the difference is substantial. You see how much is fast. It's almost instantaneous. Okay. And what I told you before, so inspect with Firebug. Well, if we just refresh the page, yeah, you see that you don't see anymore the polling because you got this switching protocols, and you see basically all the WebSockets, the negotiation and things. The last thing before going to get some beers. Is basically a thing I had in mind from a long time, and that is coming to be finally. So, in a normal beef, let's remove the WebSockets one sec. In a normal beef delivery, obviously you see everything. I mean, nothing is obfuscated or encoded, encrypted, whatever you want. So, in a normal beef situation, like this, if for example forensics guys are analyzing a breach, the response, they see that we are injecting, for example, jQuery, and all the stuff about beef, ever cookie, and so on. Okay, so it's clear. But now, yeah, let's the. But now, and also another thing that make me laugh, honestly, I received some news from friends from Spain mainly, and they said, look, there are a lot of system administrators that they are trying to prevent beef hooks with like looking for the HTTP response server headers, because we had like beef, and you know, you can just have a regex in your IPS or whatever you are using to monitor the your network, and just say, okay, if you see this in the flow, just stop the request and the reset. I don't do whatever you want, just stop it. So, or maybe looking at the hook.js, because by default this is the name that you can change, obviously, but a lot of people are not doing it. So, especially during pen test, is a good idea to be stealthy. So I added an experimental evasion extension, and also a web server imitation functionality. Everything is already in the Git repo. So web server imitation means that you can say, I want to imitate Apache, I want to imitate IIS. If you do that, all the server response headers are the same ones are as IIS or Apache. The default root page is the same one, like CentOS for Apache, and the default error page as well is displaying you the nice IIS error or the nice, for example, 404 error of Apache. So that's one thing. I mean, the idea is to, in case someone wants to not counterattack you, but like to understand what is being run by the source of that hook file, they are doing an nmap. They are using. They're trying to enumerate what kind of interfaces are exposed, but they just see normal errors. So, should be difficult to understand in this case. It's still a work in progress. It's not finished, but it's almost finished. But regarding the evasion, the idea is instead of serving a plain hook. Plain hook, plain modules every time you need to send something. You can actually apply very, very easy techniques like scrambling variables with static string substitution. For example, every time you got beef, you modify it with another string like XYZ. And you can do it randomly for every hook, taking like a hash table or in memory or in a database with all the correspondences in a way that when you send next modules, all the global variables are actually, you know the correspondence and you know how to scramble it again to have the whole thing working. Then right now, the obfuscation chain is actually scramble minify and base64. So right now it's very, very, very basic, but it's still something. That for sure is preventing that simple regexes that are not able to connect, for example, to do something else, like connect back to the service, understanding what's happening, or doing more advanced analysis, are bypassed. XOR is coming soon as well. The idea is to don't add the key in what you are sending, but maybe leave it like in the location search bar or something like that. I need to investigate more. Yes. So the result, if you enable the evasion extension. Is basically this. So this is basically the base64 decoding function that has been obfuscated until here. Okay, function deck, blah, 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 etc. Then you have basically all the content of the hook that was base64, first minified and then base64. And then at the end, to prevent that, for example, the eval keyword is cached, there are tons of ways to don't use eval in JavaScript. And so, for example, I'm using a trick that is everyone knows, like constructor. So the nice thing here is that I coded the evasion extension in a real flexible way. So if you want to add your own obfuscation technique, you just add a Ruby file here, and you call it, for example, Marcus.ruby, okay? Here you will add in the chain the position where you want to have it, depending on your logic. So Marcus here, Marcus here. Then every class, every obfuscation technique needs to basically expose three methods. Need bootstrap, get bootstrap, and execute. Need bootstrap, why? Because, for example, when you need to base64 decode something, you need obviously a bootstrap function. Okay, that doesn't need to be, for example, base64. Then get bootstrap is returning the bootstrap itself, and execute is doing the obfuscation. And this is cool because actually, in this way, everything can be called dynamically. So, for example, to apply the chain, we are checking if the technique that was specified in config yaml marcus.ruby exists, and then we are creating an instance of that class, capitalizing the name, and then executing, basically calling the method execute, because every file need to implement that. I need to add an interface. I will do it soon. And yeah, basically this is all. So I would like to thank you everyone, especially Wade, the Beef Crew, Marcus, and Mario for the invitation, and every one of you for your time. So if you have questions now or later with beers, as you prefer.